Thank you. So jumping into it, I have presented almost exactly these slides for several years now, and I gave some thought to mixing it up a bit and trying to talk a little differently about it. But so much happens in the space of a month. I think the value actually is looking at how much can change and the real value of being an investor, because so much of it is perhaps less predictable than we like to kid ourselves when we look at the historical data. So if we just jump through, there is, as always, a disclaimer. There's no advice in this presentation, as you will see as we move through it. But I'll talk about the ASX and how it has performed. You're all investors if you're here today, and you will have a reasonable eye on your portfolios, I think, and a reasonable idea of what's been happening in the market. But it's always fascinating to step back and just take a bit of a longer-term view and see how the market has performed, what's working and what isn't, because when you look at the aggregate level, you can miss some of the quite extraordinary things happening underneath, and then a couple of things to watch also. So we jump to the next slide. This is the performance of the ASX 200 over 12 months. So the chart is 12 months, as you can see, and the numbers down the side, year to date, we're up nearly 10% year to date. And this never ceases to amaze me. As I said, I have updated this over the last sort of, from the last sort of 30 days, I guess. And that number has jumped. The numbers below it have also jumped. And the numbers at the bottom have also changed. And it's really worth talking about that. When you look at the chart, that is exactly the kind of chart you want to see for the performance of your portfolio. Now, your portfolio may not replicate the ASX 200. A lot of our investors do. So a quarter of our investors under the age of 40 now only hold ETFs in their portfolio, and they tend to buy the ASX 200 first, and then they think about buying the S&P 500, usually second. But you know, this is their portfolio. This is the performance they get. For many of our investors who've been doing this for a while, they get a mix. They don't get exactly this because they have different weightings for different sectors. They have generally pretty heavy exposures to the large caps and so on. But a 10% one-year performance, sorry, 10% year-to-date performance, we're only 10 and a half months in, and a one-year performance of 17%. And you can see where that rally in the last little bit of last year, that Santa rally, how much of an impact that had, has just been quite extraordinary in an economic environment where we saw 12 interest rate increases through a period where we were expected to have none. And so much of the economy has been under pressure. We know we've been in a per capita recession for quite some time now. And yet the market is continuing to perform surprisingly strongly. The 5 and 10 year numbers, not so fun, right? The 12 month numbers are fantastic. 5 and 10 year numbers, not so good. But I do want you to focus on the dividend yield. Many, many of our investors, that is what they're there for. And it is one of the most extraordinary things, how resilient those dividends are. Now, that's fallen a little over the last month, which is interesting. So it was above 5% earlier in the year. It's now below 5%. You have to factor in franking, and there are multiple benefits to being an investor. If you're looking for yields, the ASX is a very attractive place to be. So for most of our investors, that is one of the main reasons they're so heavily overweight, Aussie stocks in particular. The other thing is to look at that historical PE. Now that has risen a little bit. So we've seen the market rally very, very hard. There's always a question, is it earnings that's driving that? There have been quite dramatic earnings expansion, or is it more that people are just willing to pay more for a dollar of earnings? It seems from that PE, it's a little more of the latter than the former, right? So earnings are holding up remarkably well given the context, but the market is just a little bit more expensive than it was. Is it hugely expensive by historical standards? No. Is it a little bit more expensive than it was? Probably yes. If we just jump to the next slide, you can see how the ASX has performed over 5 years. It took a long, long, long time for us to meaningfully recover the losses from COVID and remake that low. But you can see the difference 12 months has made. For those investors who are willing to hang on and who have stayed invested, or who took the opportunity to buy the dip, which we saw a lot of, they've done extremely well. And it's this last 12 months that's really made the difference, where we've seen a lot of new highs, and a lot of people have been enjoying that. So if we just jump to the next slide, It's also worth noting it hasn't been a particularly stressful ride. This is the VIX, so this is the volatility index, how much prices are jumping around, and it tends to be the fear index, we call it, how much people are anxious about what's going on in the market. There was a real spike there in August. There've been a few things that have popped up. It was also relatively high back in November, so you can see the market was quite low back in November, rallied very hard into Christmas, and you can see that volatility falling dramatically. It's been pretty stable for most of the year with a couple of bumps. We had the yen carry trade everyone was worried about for 5 minutes and a few other things. It's been pretty stable. Again, if we go to the next slide, you can see on a five-year basis, it's barely moving over the last 2 years, right? Very, very, very low levels of volatility, which means that performance you're getting has been relatively comfortable. You haven't had the nasty shocks quite so much on a daily, monthly, or annual basis, really. We're 2 years into relatively low volatility, and you really have to go back to COVID to see anything that was really stressful for investors. If we jump forward then, we'll compare it to the S&P 500. Now, there's nothing that says the S&P 500 has to be the best performing market in the world. It hasn't been, by the way. If you want to have a look at India, that's been quite spectacular. But it is the market that is the largest and most liquid in the world. And the performance of this US market has just been astonishing, right? When I talk about the bottom left to top right, absolutely nailed it over the last 12 months, the S&P 500. It's been an incredible performance. And investors who have been holding US equities have done extraordinarily well. If we look at the five-year numbers, which are on the next slide, COVID is barely visible on that chart, which is simply astonishing. When you compare it to what happened on the ASX, where it was a really nasty drop, it took us quite some time to remake those highs and to hold them. The biggest challenge was holding them and then resetting a base and moving up, which is what we've seen over the last 12 months. You can see in the US, they remade the highs extremely quickly. The market marched dramatically higher through to 2022. There was a very serious pullback in 2022. The NASDAQ was off 30%, and yet it bottomed out. It kind of settled down, and then throughout this year, so the last 12 months, almost perfectly 12 months as it turns out, has marched dramatically higher and has made more than 40 record highs this year, 40. So it's just been an incredible year for US equity investors. There are those who think that the 6,000 number is just unavoidable now, that it just will get reached this year. I don't want to suggest anyone count their chickens on that front, but it is simply incredible what the S&P 500 has done. So there's real value, and you can access it via the ASX in thinking about global diversification. But again, it's not like it always has to go this way. It's not that the S&P 500 always has to be such a strong performer. If we just jump to the next slide, when we look at the ASX, what has been most extraordinary over the last 12 months has been the quite divergent performance of the major sectors. So on the top left there, this is a heat map. I show it each time. If you're unfamiliar with it, it looks terrifying. If you're familiar with it, it's just a really easy way to visualize what's going on in the market and what has been happening. And it's simply the performance of the big sectors. And then if you look in the little boxes, that is each of the companies in it by size. Big box means big company. Small box means much smaller company. Red doesn't mean good, obviously. Green means great. You can see there, and in the brackets, you can see the performance of that sector. Financials up nearly 40% over 12 months. This is a one-year chart. That is unbelievable. And to the point I made earlier about whether it's price expansion, multiple expansion, or whether it's earnings expansion, most people who are on this call would be aware that the banks didn't grow their earnings by 40% over the last 12 months. They've done fine, certainly in a fairly challenging environment, but the idea that they've grown their earnings by 40% might be a little bit generous, and yet the performance has been just exceptionally strong. Healthcare's been strong. Real estate's been strong. There have been some very, very strong sectors. Materials, on the other hand, relatively weak, right? It's been an underperformer on a sector basis, just has not given us the return that we're looking for. So if we go to the next slide, you can see each of the sectors broken down. And the reason I break down three main sectors is this is what our investors hold at nabtrade. We do, as I said, have a huge number of investors now who invest almost exclusively via ETFs. They're very happy to buy and hold the market, and they do buy and hold. They are not actively trading those. They tend to, and I love this, they tend to watch the futures quite carefully. And if they know the market's going to have a rough day, they will buy more on a day when the market falls off a cliff in the morning. So we do tend to see a spike in buying when the market is expected to come off if it's been a terrible night on Wall Street. But they're generally buy and hold, and they tend to buy consistently. That is our ETF investors. We do have some investors who've been around a long time who also buy ETFs, but our investors who've been around a long time tend to have relatively well-diversified portfolios. They've been doing this a while. They know what they like and what they don't. It's been very, very interesting to see what they have been doing with financials. So banks are by far the largest holding in our investors' portfolios. They have been for a long time. We have people who bought CBA in the float, right? So it's the kind of thing that any investor who's been around for a long time is likely to hold. And it's worth noting, there was huge buying in the banks during COVID, absolutely huge. Our investors loaded up dramatically, even though they already had a lot. And so these financial portfolios tend to be quite substantial. They tend to be very overweight relative to the rest of the portfolio. And what we have seen when we saw CBA run from below $100 through to 140 odd, and we've seen the other big three also run very, very hard. Anyone who's held NAV a long time knows that the current price is pretty impressive compared to where it's been in the low 20s and down as low as sort of $16 during COVID. So we've seen this incredible run in the banks. That is making our investors quite nervous. They've got huge bank portfolios anyway, and what we have seen over the last 12 months, and it's probably tapered off a little bit recently where the banks haven't run quite as hard, and you can see that in that dip in the last month, they have been trimming, and they've been trimming pretty aggressively. They're still holding a ton of banks, but they're not buying at these prices under any circumstances, and it is quite fascinating then to ask who is buying at these prices. The answer is primarily institutions, which is hilarious, right? So retail investors trimming, institutions buying at these prices. As I said, incredible performance when you look at the year-to-date and the one-year number. The five-year number, not so fun, right? Pretty much the same as the one-year number. So you went nowhere from pre-COVID to post-COVID up until 12 months ago. 10-year number, again, not fascinating, but the dividend yield on the financials is really, really strong. The price-earnings ratio on the banks is very high by historical standards, right? That is high. So we know that really it has been investors willing to pay more for the banks, to pay more for a dollar of earnings than they've been willing to pay in the past. And that is quite interesting. We don't see that very often. And as I said, most of our guys are trimming at these prices. They're not buying more. If I jump across, materials is where the money has been going. So this has been really interesting also. Why have materials been under so much pressure? Anyone who's superstitious might like that 10-year number, by the way. So there has been a lot of pressure, mostly China stimulus packages and lack of sort of dramatic push to reinvigorate the Chinese economy through property and property development. That was very much the place to be for a long time. There's been some weakness in the iron ore price, which has come back relatively strongly, but there was quite a bit of weakness there. Lithium obviously fell off a cliff after hitting the heights. There have been a lot of parts of the materials sector that just haven't performed particularly strongly. The one-year number is not as bad as it was. So again, updating these charts month on month, it's not as bad as it was. It's come back a little bit, but the year-to-date performance has been pretty poor. The 10-year number, though, dramatically better than the banks. What's most astonishing to anyone who's been around a long time is the dividend yield is also dramatically better than the banks. And that's not something you're supposed to see in the materials sector, but here we are. So a lot of our investors have been rotating out of banks and into materials. We've seen huge buying in the big miners in particular. BHP and Fortescue are the two big favorites. We don't see a lot of Rio, which is surprising, but they're the two that our investors have been rotating into, and they've been doing that for quite some time, despite or perhaps because of the pressure on prices. If we just jump to the next slide, And Ian, I promise you I won't go over time. I will get through this very quickly. Energy's the other one. So Woodside has been our biggest buy for a while now, and we have seen a huge amount of interest. When you look at the 10-year number, that's astonishing. You're actually underwater by a third over 10-year numbers if you held the energy sector more broadly. The PE is very low. The dividend yield is extraordinarily high. We have a lot of investors who feel like there's value in that sector. If we just jump to the next slide, that's my timer. The biggest thing that is really keeping investors with one eye on what's going on overseas is the US election. So there's a lot happening there. The policies are quite fascinating if you read them. The one also that has kept so many investors awake at night is what's happening with rates. We've stopped talking about rate cuts. There was the big 50-bit bang out of the US, and now we're seeing higher rates in some spaces in the US, so they may have jumped the gun there. Still NAB not expecting rate cuts in Australia till May next year. So quite a lot to keep an eye on. And Ian, I think I'm out of time.